First time guest, Brother Hakeem Bey. Hello, Brother Hakeem. How are you?
I'm fine. I want to say peace to you and your audience, and thanks to your staff for being so very helpful, Lisa, Stephanie, Tom, and Lex.
Oh, they're good people. I was on your website over the last few days doing research for our interview, and you've got a disclaimer up there, and I wanted you to explain that first to many people, millions of people who will go to your website and want maybe a little bit more explanation on that.
All right, George, I could barely hear you. I was telling Tom this. The connection is very bad. Every time you speak, it's crackling very bad. I'm trying to my best to hear. Should I have somebody call me back, or should I just continue on?
Continue on for a little bit, and then we will call you back and reconnect in just a few minutes here.
All right, what was your question again?
As I was perusing your website, I noticed you had a disclaimer up there that someone has been using your name.
And
I wanted you to explain
that. Not so much using my name, but people often confuse me with another person who uses the pen name of Hakeem, somebody who wrote a book called Sacred Drift, Peter Lamborn Wilson, who uses the pen name of Hakeem Bey. And so oftentimes over the last 10 years or so, people have been often confusing me, and I all of a sudden got to, you know, set people straight. So that's why I put that on the, up on the site, because, you know, I heard that you was getting some emails saying that something about NAMBLA and all this type of stuff like that, which, you know, I don't have nothing to do with anything like that.
All right. Tell us a little bit about the Moorish paradigm and how you got into this.
All right. Well, the Journal of the Moorish Paradigm, well, first of all, the Journal of the Moorish Paradigm came as a result of I did many years of research, and upon doing research, you know, I myself and many people kept telling me, you need to write a book, you need to write a book. But being that this research was ongoing, every time I would get a new piece of information, then I would put it off, and I would say, all right, wait until I digest this piece of information, then I'll do the book. And I kept putting it off, and then I said, you know what, I need to put out a journal that as I'm getting this information, then I could be putting it out on an ongoing basis. So that's why I came with the concept of doing these books called Journal of the Moorish Paradigm. So as I was doing this research, I had a way to document it and put it out there, and this way I can keep on moving on to the next issue. And it's been a journey. You know, it's been a real journey.
Oh, I've got to tell you, ever since I was a kid, I've been fascinated with the story of Atlantis. You have taken it even further than some of the things I was able to digest and find, Brother Hakeem. It truly amazing. Now, when you were doing your research for this, did you start finding some conflicting stories? Whoa. I think we'll call you back. As a matter of fact, we will call you back right now and try to reconnect. They have zapped him, to be sure. Probably Chad's UFO is floating over him right now. If for some reason we lose connection with Brother Hakeem, we will go, obviously, to open lines tonight, because we will not run a tape.
Brother Hakeem,
there you are. Boy, you got zapped big time on that one.
Yes. Are you there?
Yeah.
Oh, all right. Yeah, I don't know the connection. I mean, it was fine all day long. I was speaking to Lisa and everybody, and all of a sudden now it just got terrible. But where did we leave off at?
Well, you know, when you were doing your research into Atlantis, did you mm-hmm. start finding conflicting stories from things that we had been told, things that we thought we knew a long time ago?
Yes, what I found out was one of the biggest mistakes is the belief that Atlantis sunk or was destroyed 10 to 15,000 years ago. And I think that's a mistake. Actually, the destruction of the ancient civilization, which we refer to as Atlantis, actually took place around 1500 BC or 3,500 years ago. One of the main scholars who spoke about this was a man by the name of Emanuel Velikovsky. And this was a series of worldwide cataclysms that took place. It's actually recorded in the geological record. It's actually recorded in the strata of the rocks and so on and so forth, that this series of worldwide cataclysms took place 1500 BC or 3500 years ago, and that brought about the destruction of the ancient civilization, and it was the beginning of the civilization that we know now. Now that series of cataclysms is recorded in different places in different ways, because different locations experienced it differently. So all peoples have records of this series of worldwide cataclysms, but it's recorded in their books different ways. And the Bible is recorded as the flood. It's also tied in with the so-called destruction of Babel, as well as the 10 plagues that took place in Egypt. All this is dealing with the same series of cataclysms, the volcanic eruptions dealing with Santorini and Thera and so on and so forth. All of these was all dealing with the destruction of this ancient civilization as a result of a series of worldwide cataclysms.
Do you believe that the technology that the Atlanteans possessed was so widespread, so advanced, that they might have blown themselves up?
I think that was part of it. The elders said that ancient civilization was very far advanced. The Moorish elders taught us that we had what we call a pyramid university system, which circled the whole planet like a belt. And everywhere on the planet along that belt, there were found pyramids that was all part of an energy system as well as an education system. And that was disrupted as a result of the cataclysm of 1500 BC. That whole energy system was disrupted, but it was based on the magnetic ley lines of the planet Earth, just the same way as the human body has meridians, which they use in acupuncture, and which they stimulate with needles at certain key points to stimulate the energies. We did the same thing with the planet Earth by building various temples and structures at different locations on the Earth. We stimulated the Earth energies, and it was part of a whole energy grid system. So naturally, when these geological cataclysms took place, it disrupted and broke down that whole energy system, and this is why afterwards man had to resort to animal domestication, human slavery, and so on and so forth as a form of renewable energy.
Now, this
the
cataclysm that occurred around 1500 BC was worldwide and destroyed just about everything, didn't it?
It destroyed many things, and it led to a whole. It led to mass migration of whole peoples, whole nations. The elders taught us that our inheritance was given to us by the pharaohs of Egypt. In other words, after that series of cataclysms that took place, there was a whole disruption of the different peoples, nations, whole migrations, everything took place. That's where you got the Exodus in the Bible. All this is dealing with the same cataclysm, so the lands had to be reallotted. And it was at that time that our ancestors was given what was known as the domains of Amexum.
Well, now, what is that?
The domains of Amexum, which is the inheritance of the so-called, what people today call African-Americans. I don't refer to myself as an African-American or black. I refer to myself as a Moorish American or Moor. And the domains of Amexum, actually the extent of the domains of Amexum went from Ethiopia and Egypt and Africa. Ethiopia was the demarcation line. And from Ethiopia going westward across Africa, across the Atlantic Ocean to North, South, and Central America, that formed one empire, which we refer to as the domains of Amexum, which is anciently referred to as Atlantis. The other civilization, the land, and that was given to Ham. In the Bible, he was referred to as Ham or Cam or Kemet or Egypt. That was given from that area going westward, and Kush was given from Ethiopia going eastward. And this is why in India you have India, you have the Hindu Kush mountain range. This is also why Herodotus referred to India as Eastern Ethiopia or Kush, because that was the dividing of the land between the father and the son. So we were given the domains going from Ethiopia across the Atlantic Ocean to North, South, and Central America, and this is why we was found over here in North, South, and Central America long before Columbus.
Do you believe the people had possessed some kind of special powers or higher abilities than we even have now?
Yes, the powers that they possessed was higher on a spiritual level, and it was higher in certain other areas, but not necessarily in terms of technology, a.k.a. gadgets and things of that nature. The technology at that time was more advanced, but it was on a whole different principle. It was dealing with a whole different set of energies, subtle type of energies, and so on and so forth, and it was dealing with an energy source that was renewable. Whereas now, you know, the mistake of this civilization was to base itself on a non-renewable resource, but that's a whole other thing now.
Absolutely. You know, we're going to continue chatting with you up to the top of the hour, Brother Hakeem, and then reschedule you because the crackiness of the phone is just way out of whack for us.
Yeah,
we don't want to keep pushing this. It'll be two or three more hours of this, and you'll jump off a cliff.
Yeah, no, but
I'll jump with you.
I mean, if I had to, I would, but hopefully during the break we'll be able to, you know, get a better connection. Because, and also in the meantime, I want to tell your audience, please, if you get a chance to go up, because this is going to be very important to really get the fullest of what I'm going to be speaking about, is to see the slideshow. I put up a slideshow. It has 100 different clips, slides of different images, artifacts, documents that will all substantiate what I'm saying. So, you know, if you get a chance, go to it. I sent Lex some mirror links.
Yes,
also.
And he's got some great material that you sent him up there on the website already.
So all right, beautiful.
He works quickly.
Yeah, I know. All right, I set up some mirror sites because I know, you know, the website may get slammed, but, you know, I have some mirror sites set up also.
I love it, Brother Hakeem, when we shut down everybody's websites.
I know. I've been listening to Coast for years, so I already knew. I know it's going to happen, so I'm already bracing myself.
Do we face the same possibilities as the people on Atlantis, the people who were in Iraq during the crisis of the Tower of Babel in Babylon? Problems like that occurred because of catastrophes, whether it was religious or not. Do we face that same problem?
We're right there right now. You know, in the fourth book that I wrote, book number four, I had a picture in there, and it was a picture of a tarot card known as the Tower. And in that tarot card, it shows a tower being struck by lightning and people falling out and jumping out and in fire and flames and so on and so forth. And this was before 9/11 took place, and I put this out. And in it, I was saying that in it, I said this. I'm reading right from the book. It says this card also symbolizes the destruction of Atlantis, the Tower of Babel, and any great power that loses touch with the divine. This will be the fate of America in the present world order if this does not go. If this world does not go on a sort of global spiritual retreat with the divine. And then I pointed out. I said, notice the crown falling from the tower. Nobody or nation is too great to fall. We must be humble and balanced in order to bear fortune and misfortune. And so here, just like Atlantis, you know, it's like I've seen it, and I knew the way the civilization is going right now. In other words, America is part of a great divine experiment. And we still have a chance right now. America still has a chance to fulfill its destiny in history. But certain things have to come out that was shoved underneath the rug. And if it's not brought out and dealt with, then, you know, it's not going to happen. This could be one of the greatest nations on the face that ever existed. But it's up to the people, and it's important that the people get the truth so that they can make the correct decisions in this day and time.
When Atlantis went down, did it take with it that what we've always heard, some kind of crystal power source? What do you think?
Well, the crystal power, the power source was dealing with the earth and dealing with the natural energies, and it was dealing with the energies that was within us. So, in actuality, you know, the energy which is within us and the knowledge of it never actually died. It's not actually gone. It still exists right now. But things have to change in order for it to come to fruition, in order for it to come forward. So the power source there was an energetic source, but it was also like biological, where the people had a role to play. They was part of it themselves.
Did they possess this kind of energy themselves?
Yes, we all possess these energies ourselves. You know, I mean, you know, in science and all kinds of things have been proving it. But this civilization, with regards to stuff like that, is at a very, very baby stage compared to Atlantis.
You've heard of the group ZZ Top, right? The musical group. And Billy Gibbons was talking with me a few days ago, and he has this incredible ability, as so many other people do, of walking past streetlights and things like that, mm-hmm. and they go on and off as he walks by. Is it that kind of energy you're talking about?
Yes, that's all part of it. That is all part of it. As a matter of fact, it's funny you used to say that. I had that experience all the time when I walk. I do a lot of walking, and there's a certain light that every time I go past it, it cuts off and it cuts on, you know, like clockwork. So, yeah, these are just examples. These are glimpses that we have every day, but we often just walk past it and we don't recognize it.
So many things happened so many years ago, and it's just lost knowledge, that even to this day we don't possess. You know, you talked about ley lines. We've got that story of Coral Castle, which we've talked about so many times. I talked about it last night, where that 100-pound fellow, Edward Leedskalnin, put his facility, his structure, near special ley lines. This guy understood this. Mm-hmm. Why have we lost the knowledge?
I think, you know, It's because of the lifestyle. If you look at these people like him, like Victor Schauberger, like Tesla, like George Washington Carver, these are people that they seen the world and they seen nature from a different set of eyes. You know what I'm saying? And they was able to observe nature. See, the average person experience is the effects of nature. But they was able to go behind that veil and actually see the causes of these things. So naturally, they seen things from a whole different angle, and mainly because it was their lifestyle. Most of them, if you look at most of them, they live relatively poor. They didn't have a whole lot of money. And oftentimes, like Victor Schauberger or George Washington Carver, they were very close to nature. And this is the key. This is the key, because all the secrets are embedded and embodied in nature. And because we lost that connection with nature, we walk on concrete all day, you know, we don't have a direct connection with nature no more. Sometimes when I see people all disrupted and crazy, I tell them, I said, you know, take a day off from work, go into the woods, take off your shoes and socks, and put your feet into the earth, into the soil, and reconnect, you know, and yeah. Reconnect. And then you would tie, and then you will easily discover those energies. You sit by a river, and you just observe, you just watch, you just meditate, and all kinds of things will come to you.
How did you find this? Did you stumble into it? Was it knowledge given to you?
Oh, wow. Well, in terms of this, which is my life work, in terms of doing these different things, actually, I mean, when I really look at it, I mean, I can really trace it back to the time I was young, you know, 5 years old, and experimenting and fooling around with magnetics and electricity and so on and so forth. But to carry it further up to now, I had certain experiences that happened to me, and I'm somewhat of a storyteller, so I would love to share, you know, these stories with your audience in terms of how did I come around to this? Because coming up in New York City in the South Bronx, you know, many of the things that I've learned and I've been involved with will seem like it's almost like it don't match. It don't go together.
All right, you stay on the line. I'm going to have Tom come back to you and see if that scratchiness goes away. If it does not, what we'll do with your brother Hakeem is reschedule you when we know the phone lines are fixed on either end. I think it's coming from your end somehow, but we'll double-check that. And if for some reason we can't get Brother Hakeem back on, well, we'll have open lines for you, and I'll give you the numbers when we come back. No need to give them to you yet. I'm George Norrie. This is Coast to Coast AM. Man, in this age of incredible technology and satellites and our ability to take pictures of Saturn and Jupiter and beam them back, they still can't get phones working from wherever people might be. So the crackling line with Brother Hakeem is just, it's too annoying. I think it would distract from some of the great information he has, so we will just have to reschedule with him at a later date.